Hello, hello. It's Pamela Wilson, and I am here with Douglas Burdett. I'm so glad that you made the time to attend this or to watch this presentation after the fact. Douglas Burdett is the host of the Marketing Book Podcast. He calls himself a marketing guide and therapist, and I'm going to be asking him about that therapist moniker because, I mean, who doesn't need a marketing therapist in this life, right? So we'll be talking about that. He is a former artillery officer. He's a Madison Avenue ad man, and he's a, I mean, I don't know if it's a former stand-up comedian or current stand-up comedian. I'm going to get clarification on that as well. Douglas's business is called Sales Artillery. It's located in Norfolk, Virginia, which is probably about to get hit by a big bomb cyclone.
It's already so dark here now.
Yeah. So I just put his URL on the screen, salesartillery.com. That's where you can find us, find him and find us right here, actually. Douglas, thank you so much for being here. I really, really appreciate it.
Oh, well, thank you. It's always good to talk to you. And I've, just so folks know, I've interviewed Pamela twice on the Marketing Book Podcast about her two excellent books. And how excellent are her books? One of them was stolen from my office. And I collect autographed sales and marketing books. Don't judge. But she sent me another one. And then I also interviewed you, as you know, I interviewed Pamela for a special series I did during the lockdown called Authors in Quarantine Getting Cocktails. So, yes. And I should also add, I am able to see comments. So if you're out there and you are, let us know who's here, because I want to find out if maybe some Marketing Book Podcast listeners have joined us. And if not, maybe I'll pick up some new listeners.
Yes, exactly. I highly recommend your podcast. It's such a great way to stay up to date with what's happening in the marketing world and hear from the mouths of experts. It's really a wonderful podcast.
That would be my guess. Yes.
And of course, you're a good host. So you and I have been in the marketing space for a long time. And, you know, I have in my notes here, you filled out a form to give us some information before we met today. And I saw that one of your goals was to make me laugh. And I just want to make sure that you came prepared for that, because that's what my notes say.
Well, you're a tough audience. So, okay.
All right. But that leads into my first question, which is, you know, we've been doing this for a long time, marketing. And I just wonder, has humor helped you during your long marketing career to kind of survive all the ups and downs?
I think so. I think it's helped me, you know, through life. I was the youngest child, so I don't know where you came in on the rank order there, Pamela, but the youngest children often are maybe a little more creative and funnier, and it's really a survival technique. If my older brothers could still beat me up, they would. And also, you know, I had a little bit of a stressful childhood in elementary school. I mean, a lot of people have stressful childhoods. My dad was gone fighting in Vietnam on two tours. And that's, you know, when dad's not around, that's hard on families and little kids like me. So I was kind of the class clown, always have been. I don't think it's going to change. But then when I started performing stand-up comedy formally in lieu of a midlife crisis, and I'm all better now, thank you. But a lot of my friends who'd known me forever had said, "What took you so long?" So I think it's been really helpful. I'm a big fan of comedy and admirer of things comedic, and I can't help but make jokes. That doesn't mean I'm funny. It just means I think I'm funny. And my wife would tell you there's a big difference there.
I love it. Yeah, I love it. And I think that sense of humor can be really important when you've had a long career like ours, because you just see so many changes. You have these things that you think are completely solidified in cement as, you know, this is just the way we do these things. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly something comes along that completely disrupts it. And a lot of people's reaction is to become very fearful, run for the hills, you know, this is the end of everything as we know it and all that. And mm-hmm. I think the ability to laugh a little bit can be super helpful. So you said you're a marketing therapist. I need to ask you a therapy type question.
Sure. And so, like Stuart Smalley, I am not a licensed clinical therapist. So
exactly. But you are a clinically committed marketing person. And I'm sure you've done a lot of client therapy
over the years. Ready to let healing begin, Pamela.
There we go. So, all right. So the big thing that is on everyone's minds right now and on the tips of their tongues and the tips of their fingertips on social media especially is ChatGPT and AI. You and I booked this conversation, I think it was back in October, when those things had not hit our screens and consciousnesses, and now they're there, and lots of people are talking about them. And there seems to be this
October's ancient history.
I know, seriously. So what I'm noticing is it's almost like a pendulum that people are swinging between feeling completely terrified and feeling super excited. So I'm wondering where you fall in that spectrum and what you can share about your thoughts about all that.
Well, I think both reactions are normal. See, I sound like a therapist, don't I? That's interesting. Why do you say that? How does that make you feel, Pamela? No, okay, I'll spare you. My father-in-law was a psychiatrist and my mother-in-law was a psychologist, so I know all
you have
tricks.
The lingo down pat.
Right. And it's normal to be maybe to be excited. I think most people are fearful and they're probably thinking, oh, there's one more thing I gotta deal with. But it reminds me, because you talked about we've been in the business for a while, and I remember in the late 1980s I was working at J. Walter Thompson, big ad agency in New York City, and there were two type guys. And what that means for the younger viewers is you would have to send out for the type, and the type would get set, and then you would have to paste it into a board. I don't know if I'm explaining this right.
I get the whole thing. I still have rubber cement fumes completely embedded in my lungs. So, yes.
You would send out to a type setter. Typesetters, and they would prepare it all. Mm-hmm. And one day, and so we had these two guys, because it was a big agency, and they dealt with all the type houses.
That's all they did. Well, yeah.
It was that big a deal. And one day, they were both fired. And do you know who they were fired by? Was the creative director, Jim Patterson, who's gone on to become the famous novelist James Patterson.
No way.
Yeah, he was the creative director.
And did he just see the desktop revolution coming and realize he wasn't going to need that?
He did. But it was a little earlier than we thought, but it was a similar sort of thing where it was like all of us were thinking like, wait a minute. And the art directors were furious, and there might have been 30 art directors. I mean, there was a big agency, and these guys were just amazed. And so everyone said, well, what are we going to do? They say, well, they got this guy down the fourth floor with a computer. He's going to do it.
Yeah.
And so that was like a story. So when you say we've seen things happen over the years, it almost desensitizes us a little bit, I think, because it's like, you know, you just get used to the disruptive change. And I think that it could go back to people, do they either have a growth mindset or a fixed mindset? You can Google growth mindset versus fixed mindset, where a growth mindset is more of a learning mindset, and you can take it. You know, you can take it. You could take the change a little bit more easily, and you might see more opportunity in change. Now, change is really pretty frightening to the human brain because it's normally meant, you know, danger. Mm-hmm. But with all this AI and that sort of thing, I read something the other day about how it's, you know, it's really like the steam shovel. I don't know, 150 years ago, it suddenly made things better. You know, you didn't have to have a whole field of guys digging a hole. You had to use this machinery to make bigger improvements, make it go faster, more profitably, that sort of thing. And all the hole diggers, a lot of them found other work, which is, you know, I don't mean to be sounding like I'm telling you, oh, learn to code, but there are certain changes. But I don't know, I guess at this point, I don't know the point in fighting it. You know, look for the opportunity. And it also seems like it could, you know, dramatically enhance the capabilities of people who embrace it.
Yeah.
So
exactly.
I'm excited. I don't know that there's much point in fighting it. And, you know, there's the notion, I read about this the other day in Jeb Blunt's book, Selling in a Crisis, which is a very timely book for 2023. And he said, there's really only three things you can ever control. Although we want to think we can control more things. You can control your actions. You can control your reactions. And you can control your mindset. Those are the only three things you can control.
Wow. That is amazing.
That stuck with me all week.
Yeah. That's great. So, yeah. I love that. It's so interesting because I think, you know, we'll end up building a new set of skills when it comes to ChatGPT, which for anyone, I should have probably defined it before we started, but ChatGPT, by the time you're watching this, you probably know what this is. But it's basically an AI engine that allows you to input very specific prompts and get long responses all written out for you. It's not perfect. It is... it's sometimes inaccurate, and that's where a human involvement, I think, is going to be really important. It will likely get more accurate over time, but that it's a like a weird new skill to know how to create inputs that actually get you outputs that you can use and sort of see as, you know, I have this very, very junior copywriter on staff now, right? Who's just learning the ropes and I'm going to edit their work. And so it becomes an editing skill, you know? And almost like an idea generator, right?
Yeah. I mean, if you could, if it's possible, and if you're threatened by this, and I completely understand it if you are, but think about how this could actually help. Mm-hmm. Just try it. You know, there was, I don't know how we're doing on time, but I wanted to mention there was a book on the show. Well, there have been about 420 books on the show, but there was a book on the show a couple years ago by Philip Kotler, the father of modern marketing. I don't know if you can see that.
Yes.
Marketing 5.0. And I remember this because I knew we were going to, we might talk about this. And in the book, and he's written Marketing 3.0 and Marketing 4.0, and he's in his early 90s, and he's got several books in the pipeline. But they talk about, you know, there are certain things that machines do really, really well. And for me, it was sort of like, stop trying to do it, Douglas. Let the machines help you. But then there are certain things a human can always do better than a machine. And let me just mention, if I could.
Of course. And we have all the time in the world.
Okay. So in terms, these are like four things, and machine versus human. Okay. Mm-hmm. So a machine is efficient at processing data, extracting information, and managing knowledge. A human is capable of screening out noise, drawing out insight, and developing wisdom. So like you're talking about, you can see, you still need a human to evaluate the work that the ChatGPT is creating. The machine is adept at convergent, structured thinking and discovering patterns. Mm-hmm. The human is skilled in divergent thinking and finding out-of-the-box solutions. The machine is excellent at using logical thinking and follows specific algorithms. And we are trying to help them get better.
Yeah, that tracks with what we're talking about. That's perfect.
Yeah, and the human is great at using empathy to create a connection that resonates. Anybody mention humor? And finally, the machine is reliable for repetitive and programmable tasks at speed and scale. And the human is flexible for tasks that demand contextual understanding and common sense reasoning. And there was one other book that I was on the show this year that I recommend if you want to learn more about this, called Marketing Artificial Intelligence by, let me turn the light off. Paul Roetzer and Mike Kaput. And again, I have links to the interviews if you want to listen to this before you decide to buy the book. But it's really well done. They both have a journalism background. And they explain it in a way that makes it really not frightening and kind of gets you excited. And then they give all these examples of companies that provide these types of tools. They're not pitching those companies, but they're showing examples of how much in the right instances, certain tools have helped companies dramatically. The machine learning AI kind of tools. So Marketing Artificial Intelligence is another good one if you're interested in that. And could I also add, I see we've got Mark Manuel on the in the audience here. He is a longtime Marketing Book podcast listener. And Pamela, I don't know if you realize this, but I have the most attractive listeners in all of podcast land.
You have mentioned that.
Yeah, that's a fact check true. Okay?
That's amazing.
I got science to back that up. And Mark is one of those people who is, he is not an unattractive man. So if there are others out there, you know, and I've met a lot of them, I've seen them on LinkedIn, and I don't think they're using stock photos of models for their LinkedIn profiles.
Right. I love it. I love it. Well, Mark, thank you for being here. It's great. It's great to have you here. It's so interesting to talk about AI and people's responses to it. I do think that we're in a really interesting time of flux and transition. And transitions are always kind of scary.
Yes.
There's been a lot of attention paid to AI art as well. I went to art school. That was how I started out. You know, I'm a visual person. And so that side of things has been concerning to me as well, that AI is going to, I don't think they do a great job yet, but apparently there was a comic book that was submitted to the U.S. Copyright Office, and they requested to get a copyright on this comic book art that had been generated by AI. And the Copyright Office announced that it was revoking the copyright that it initially granted to this piece of work, saying that, and I'm going to read this, copyrighted works must be created by humans to gain official copyright protection.
Oh, interesting.
So, but that's where we are right now, that we're figuring all that out. And I do think that, you know, human beings will prevail, and we are running the show. And so in the end, right. I mean, yes. And I think we're always going to want to run the show. That's the thing. So I think we're always going to want to keep the upper hand. So this idea that it was initially granted and then they rescinded it because they realized, oh, actually, we need to draw a line in the sand, and works need to be created by a human in order to have copyright protection. So that we're in that weird in-between
place.
That
is really interesting.
Yeah. Well, I knew we were going to talk about it, so I was gathering information as well. And I'll look into the book you mentioned. That's a great, great share. I appreciate that.
Well, I have more if you need, so be careful.
I got a lot of book recommendations to ask you about. So if you're watching this, actually get something to write with, because we have a lightning round coming at the end of this interview where I'm going to be asking Douglas about all sorts of different books. And if you are working on creating a reading list for the coming year, this is going to be a great way to build your reading list. So, all right, I wanted to ask you about fractional CMOs. These are chief marketing officers who are doing the marketing officer job on a part-time basis. They're working with internal teams who are doing a lot of the implementation. I wonder if you have opinions about this trend. I'm kind of asking for a friend, so I want to know what you think about this.
Well, I think it was Aristotle who said the more you learn, the more you learn you don't know. And I guess I could say, if I were smarter, I wouldn't have to read all these books. But I've heard about fractional CMOs, and I don't know a whole lot about it, honestly. But I'm, you know, perfectly comfortable not knowing things. My only thought about that is that I don't know if it's – I've seen like you and Carla Johnson
mm-hmm.
and Neil Schaefer have that on LinkedIn profiles, and lots of other folks. Really, the first thing that came to mind, and then I'm going to ask you to tell me more about it, but the first thing that came to mind is how, if you're a fractional CMO, how do you keep scope creep managed, as they say, I think it's in the military, you know, because let's say you're a 25 percenter, they're still going to expect you there all the time. But what is that an emerging role or what can you tell me about it?
Yeah, it's interesting.
Maybe there's a book you could write about it.
I know, seriously. I'm already thinking about the next book. But yeah, so I saw that trend, and honestly, I kind of resisted it for a long time, because this idea that you're a fractional CMO sounds a lot just like you're a high-level marketing consultant, and they just are giving it a name, you know? So I don't know. I sort of resisted it for a long time, but what I've come to realize is that people who are in more of a small business, growing small business, or kind of corporate space, they understand that CMO term. They just understand it. And the fractional idea is, you know, we're going to hire somebody to come in and fulfill that role, but they will not be full-time. We don't need full-time. In some cases, the company just doesn't need, if you have a marketing consultant who has a lot of experience and mm-hmm. can work with an internal team who can do some of the day-to-day implementation, that person doesn't really need to be full-time.
Okay, but you need an internal team to be...
You need somebody doing... I mean, it doesn't have to be internal. It could be external. But basically, if the C... I mean, somebody who's operating at a C level should not really be doing the implementation anyway, right? They're sort of setting strategy, right? So you're setting strategy, and then you're working with someone. It could be an internal team. It could be an external team to make that strategy real, to implement it and get it... deployed, as you would say in the military, right? So, right? So I see it as that. And yeah, I've been brought on as a fractional CMO with this healthcare industry business, and I'll be doing that in 2023. But it's one quarter of my time. So I'm actually actively looking for other businesses who either need a fractional CMO or a marketing advisor, because it's not going to take all my time. It just doesn't. You know, I've known this company for a long time, and they have a great, super strong internal team. So setting the strategy and then overseeing the implementation. And honestly, I mean, maybe CMO jobs, if they're well structured, don't ever need to be full time. I'm probably going to get rotten tomatoes thrown at me for that one. But
the one of the issues seems to be that you need to be working with a company that would otherwise have a chief marketing officer. I would be concerned about a smaller company thinking, oh, she's our marketing person. Like, that's it. And it seems like there's a real, it's real important that you get the fit right. And maybe it's a company that understands strategy and what a CMO is there for.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Because I mean, at a C level, I think most people would assume that you are doing some management, right? So, you know, you probably have team members that you're managing. Like I said, they might be internal or external, but it's a new way of working. And the company that I'm doing this for has other people at the C level who are fractional. They have a fractional CFO, for example. In this case, they're sort of still in the startup realm, and some of the founders are covering some of those bases as well. So it's like it's a growing business. It's every week is a little bit different. So,
if they have other C-level people that are fractional,
they seem to be comfortable with that model.
Otherwise, if they're new to that, there seems like there need to be a lot of expectation setting and and drawing the line
boundaries.
In the sand.
It's about boundaries. You have to have, I mean, I gave them a proposal that had very specific, you know, strategies laid out. It's like, this is what I will be doing. And I also included a section that said, I will not be doing these things. I have a design background. I can do copywriting. I can do content marketing. I mean, there are a lot of things I could do. And I was very specific about, I am not your designer. I'm not your copywriter. Like, I will help you find those people, but that is not. So I think that's part of it as well. Just setting expectations and being super clear in the proposal stage about what you will and won't do. So that everybody knows.
And is it true, Pamela, that in the proposal, you said, when I'm in the building, you will have no eye contact with me.
All right, I'm checking off the made me laugh thing on my list. You
got
that one.
You have to put stuff in there just to, you know, just like the brown M&Ms that Van Halen would put in their contract.
M&Ms. It's actually almost all virtual with this client. So I guess it's you will not make eye contact with me in Zoom, something like that. So, all right, well, here's the next question. Then I wonder, you know, again, you and
I had to invite me on.
All right. We've been doing this for a long time, and I wonder, when you look ahead in the next say 3 to 5 years? Like, what do you see kind of coming down the pike in the marketing world that you think is really interesting, that you're looking forward to, that you're concerned about? I would love to hear about any of that that you want to share.
Well, I think in the next 3 to 5 years, everyone will have their own flying car. Entire meals will come in pill form, and the earth will be run by damn dirty apes.
Oh, man. That goes way beyond what I was expecting, Douglas Burdett. Wow.
Okay, I have to give a hat tip. That was Austin Powers. That's when he was telling Felicity Shagwell about what the future was like, because he came back from the future. And honestly, I don't know, just like I don't know about fractional CMOs, but every year, less and less, but I would get these things saying, hey, we're doing a roundup of marketing people, and can you tell us what your predictions are? And I always send that. Mm. And then they never ask me again.
It's a good way to get people out of your inbox,
well,
I guess.
Yeah, I should respond for the visibility, but I don't know. I think 2023 might be much worse a year than people are ready for. It just based on what I've heard, and who knows if that's complete, but the economy is going to get really
worse. In what way? The economy, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. I think it's going to continue with the inflation. I think the interest rates may go up a little bit more. I mean, these really big.
And then
smart
how will that impact marketing though? Those of us who are doing marketing, what will happen? Do you think?
I think there's an opportunity there. Well, for companies, maybe not so much for the marketers, but there's this desire to want to hunker down, okay, mm-hmm. and start laying people off. And I was just like I mentioned I interviewed Jeb Blunt. They had this big coaching training job they were going to do with this company with a big sales force. They laid off their whole sales force.
Oh wow!
Not Jeb, but the prospect he was working with. Hmm. And so I think there'll be continued disruption, although I think with the lockdown in 2020, people are kind of maybe a little more agile or flexible. But in other words, mayhem, just like you've branded this talk. But I think that there's still an opportunity for marketers who have a learning mindset. They want to keep learning, because those are the ones that are always successful. They're the ones that are looking for jobs less, constantly learning. And I'm not saying you have to listen to the Marketing Book podcast, but you will be better looking if you do. But in a time where companies are spending less and less training their people, there's never been a better time for learning about all the changes that are going on in marketing. And there was an interview I saw one of the HubSpot founders a couple of years ago, they were asking him, what is it you look for in an employee? And the answer was, I look for learn-it-alls. That was the number one thing they're looking for. What he meant by that was people who are interested in learning. They want to continuously improve themselves. And they're not told to go learn about something. They learn about something, they figure it out, then they help their company and their client. And that's also there's a big bit of leadership in there, even if you're a low-level marketing person. But in a field that's changing so much, I think this next year we're going to see more and more people who are going to benefit from continuously learning and trying new things and trying to help their organization. But beyond that, there's a sort of a hunker down mentality. Hopefully this is going to send us back to the basics. Of marketing, and maybe understand marketing. And what I mean by that is not simply promotion, which too many people still think is marketing. Marketing in terms of what is our product, what problem are we solving, how are we making it available and distributing it, what new ways can we price our product that would work better. All that's marketing. And I think that younger people are going to better understand that, younger executives. And I think we still need a few more funerals and retirements by some senior people who still think that marketing is what it was when they started their careers in 1985. Because they're still selling that way. Yeah. They're still messaging that way.
Right.
And yet they'll be the first to admit that that doesn't work for them, and that they don't get their purchase decision information from ads necessarily.
Right. Yeah.
So anyway, that's a long-winded way of saying I don't know.
Yeah, no, I get that, and it's so interesting to think about hunkering down and the fact that I'm pretty sure that all of us have been in a permanent crouch position since early 2020. So, you know, I think we're kind of used to it, and let's hope that we can operate from that place of not really knowing what's coming down the pike. It's definitely a time of uncertainty, but I love that you brought up that growth mindset, because in times like this, that's the kind of mindset that will help you the most. The kind that says, all right, this is kind of weird, but like, how can I make the most of it, right? This is kind of not what I expected, and yeah.
Or somebody who gets laid off and then they're really thinking about, you know, what they want out of their life and career, and they do some good hard thinking that we normally don't want to do. They may get some certifications, or they might start a blog, or they'll actually be forced to kind of listen to themselves and maybe take stock of what they're really good at and what they don't like, and what direction they could go, you know? So I guess they say, you know, one door closes, another one opens, or in chaos lies opportunity. And these are, you know, kind of trite, and they're not helpful if you just lost your job. But there are so many examples of companies that double down on certain things, like the basics of sales, or getting back in touch with their customers in bad times. When the economy picks up, they do really even better than their competition, who's been hunkered down. Yeah. And so I would hope that in 2023, we might get back to the idea of, are we selling as much as we can to our customers? Are we listening to our customers? Are we, are we paying attention to what their fears, their issues are, so that we might better serve them? There's such an unnecessary obsession with net new customers all the time that sometimes marketing departments are told, just get net new customers, and yet the company they've lost touch with their current customers, who probably want to buy from them again. They already trust them, and yet they're not doing it. And of course, there have been books on the show about, you know, before you start marketing and trying to get new customers, step back for a minute, think about the experience your customers are having with you, and are you doing everything you can to help them?
Retention. No, but yeah.
More of your customers like you than I think a lot of companies realize.
Right. Right. Like you and would like to buy other things from you, right? Continue to work with you in other ways. Right. Exactly. Yeah.
But don't call them up and say, what do you need? Call them up and say, how's it going? What's going on?
Exactly.
Find the friction in their life.
I love that. And when things slow down, that's an opportunity. I mean, you have a bit more time to do that kind of thing, right? Have those conversations.
Like in the lockdown, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
There were so many authors I spoke to, like you. I did 66 episodes of Authors in Quarantine Getting Cocktails.
Oh, wow.
I continued to publish a book interview every Friday, but every other day I would have this. And then after 66 episodes, my liver needed a rest.
I was going to say, yeah, that's a lot of cocktails. Hey, yeah.
I suffer for my art, Pamela. Yeah. But there were so many, and these are, you know, guests on the Marketing Book Podcast. They're really interesting, smart people. And a lot of them were saying, when was the last time you talked to your customer? Pick up the damn phone. Mm-hmm. They're not talking to anybody anyway. It was just interesting, you know, because some of them had such a perspective. And that's why I really enjoyed doing that, because it was a crazy time, and none of the authors could travel and speak, and they were all drinking. So they said, I'll be happy to talk to you, Douglas. So,
you right. Know, it was an easy
opportunity
yes.
in bad times, right?
Right. Exactly. Right. Yeah. I love that. Yeah. That was by far the most fun interview I've ever done. I mean, come on.
Well. Everybody should know that's the alcohol talking.
I know. It was. It totally was. It was fun. And again, that was you making us all, you know, laugh a little in the middle of a situation that was not fun for any of us.
Yeah.
So.
Gosh, it took me back to my childhood. I should have listened to my in-laws when they were always trying to explain to me what my issues are. They kept asking me about my childhood, but I didn't really want to go into it.
I love it. All right. Well, I have this lightning round of questions I want to ask you. You have read at this point hundreds and hundreds. Do you have a total count of how many marketing books you've read?
Well, probably between 450 and 500. I mean, in the course of my career, but I've had I've had episode 4. Let's see. As we record this, tomorrow is episode. Wait for it. Tomorrow is episode 415.
Wow.
And then there's some, you know, I do actually read other books. And then there have been some books I read that I didn't. And I actually interviewed the author, and it was a terrible interview. Mm. Sometimes because they didn't actually write the book, it turns out.
Mm. Yeah, that happens.
So I didn't publish those interviews. But so anyway, there have been a lot of them. And I just, it's not a chore. I like doing it. And every single book I read, I slap my forehead and say, Douglas, how did you not know about that? So like I said, you know, the more you learn, the more you realize you don't know. Mm-hmm. And anyway, so I've never been one of those people that felt like he was the smartest person in the room. I mean, I'm here by myself, but you know, my golden retriever
is
here.
It's you and a lot of books, let's be real. Yes. Yeah. Aw, so cute. And,
he's pretty smart. So anyway, so there's been a lot of books.
Yes, I love it.
And
all
actually,
right.
If I could interject one thing for your audience, if I don't want anyone to have to read that many sales and marketing books, because not everyone's going to enjoy it like I do. So if there's one or two books, if there's like a specific problem or challenge you're facing, message me, you know, on LinkedIn or whatever, and I'll see if there's like maybe one or two books that could help you right now. So you don't have to, you know, jump around or whatever resource I know of. Every day I hear from listeners around the world asking me for very specific book recommendations, including one in Colombia not too long ago who asked me about it's a good marketing strategy book. And I said, hey, I know somebody, and she actually lived in Colombia and she speaks Spanish.
That's so
cool. I don't
know
if you ever connected with her, but yeah.
That's so cool. So you're like a reference librarian for marketing books is what you're saying.
Yeah. All right. But I'm not like a hot librarian.
Okay. But you know, it's good. That's good. It's good to know somebody who's a reference librarian for these kinds
of books. Yeah. And it only takes a few seconds for me to go, oh, read this one.
Yeah. I love it. Yeah. All right. So make a note, everyone. Find Douglas Burdett on LinkedIn maybe is the best place. If you need a recommendation for a book. But in the meantime, I have this lightning round of questions I want to ask you about all sorts of book recommendations. So are you ready? Are you ready to get started?
As Gary Gilmore said, let's do it.
All right, here we go. So the best marketing book that you have read or the best book you've read on the art of sales?
Well, there have been over 50 sales books on the show over the years, and if anyone wants a PDF of a document of a link to every one of the interviews, message me and I'll send it to you. But when you say the art of sales, I think probably the first sales book I ever had on the show was New Sales Simplified by Mike Weinberg. Mm. It's really hard to say that because the sales books, I just love them, and they've really, every one of them has been exceptional. And I like having all the sales books because marketers who understand sales are much more successful at marketing and helping their companies grow revenue. Yes. But sadly, a lot of those authors say, you know, a lot of companies they deal with, the marketing people have no idea what sales does, which is a real shame.
Yeah, that's such a weird disconnect that does happen. I see that a lot too. So, yeah. All right. So we have the art of sales. What about the science of sales?
Well, this one's easy. The Science of Selling by David Hoffeld.
Okay.
And he actually wrote another book that was on the show in 2022 called Sell More with Science. It's really interesting. He said he's a real geek where all he does, I think the first book, there was like 200 or 400 academic reports he studied. He just loves it, about psychology and all that sort of thing. And he extracted from that how people make buying decisions. It was just fascinating. It's really good. The Science of Selling.
That's awesome. Okay, that's great.
Yeah. And it's a great book for marketers and content creators. Right. Because it teaches you that, like, this, maybe I think it was like 6 questions that every customer, even subconsciously, is asking themselves. And if you can't address that, you're not going to get any further with them.
Right, exactly. Oh my gosh, I love that. All right. I'm going to build my own reading list from this. This is great. All right, what about content marketing? This is a method for marketing that has developed in the last 15 years, let's say, taken a really, you know, it's really a very public way to market on the internet, content marketing. What about I'm going to ask you about the art of content marketing and the science of content marketing. So what book would you recommend for the art of content marketing?
And I should add, you know, the content marketing has become even more popular lately, but it's hundreds of years old. I mean, the Michelin Guide.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Was content marketing, because they were there was a tire company trying to get people to drive more. So they had a book all about restaurants and destinations that you could go visit. And by the way, please buy our tires when you drive there. So the art of content marketing, and I just, so the audience knows, I'm not allowed to say Pamela Wilson's book, although I already plugged one. Everybody Writes by Anne Hanley. The second edition, just came out.
Just updated, right, yes.
And it's about, it's almost 400 pages, 91 short chapters. That's one of those, you know, 10 books that every marketer should read. It's, she's just phenomenal. Her book, and it's a Wall Street Journal bestseller, but her book is so interesting to me. First off, it's really funny. And I know funny. I'm a clownfish. But ever since I read that book a few years ago, it's like Anne has always been sitting there with me, encouraging me, you know, telling me, you know, guiding me, and keeping that middle school substitute English teacher out of the room who once said, you don't know how to write. Or that boss who said you don't know how to write. It's a great book for the art of content marketing, and it helps demystify it, and it also makes it fun. It's one of my favorite books.
Yeah, she has such an encouraging voice, I think, you know, and it's important, because people who are creating content, you know, it's a very public art, right? You're publishing it for the whole world to see, and it has a marketing purpose. So it takes some courage, and a voice that feels encouraging, that you've got stuck in your head, is a great voice to have when you're sitting down to create content. Love it. All right. What about this?
You know what?
Oh, yes.
Your book, Master Content Strategy, is the one that was stolen out of my office. My first edition of Everybody Writes was stolen. I couldn't find it.
I'm in good company. This is good.
Yeah, I know. Those two books were stolen. I think it's an intern we had from a while back, and maybe she was just going to borrow them. And my former content director reached out to her to say, hey, do you have those? Douglas kind of wants them back.
Oh my gosh, I love it. I love it.
Thank you for giving me another copy.
That's awesome. Yes, of course.
And actually, your book, along with Everybody Writes, was actually on my content director's desk. And I think I sent you a picture of that one day.
You did. Yeah.
In the wild.
Yeah, I know. That was so great to see.
He's a content director.
Yeah, that's great to see. Thank you. You weren't supposed to plug my book.
I know.
So, okay. What about the science of content marketing? I feel like I know what you're going to say here, but which one are you going to share for the science of content marketing?
Let's see. Science? How about Content Chemistry by Andy Crestodino?
I knew it.
Volume 6, though. Make sure you get volume 6.
Yes. Yeah, he updates that consistently. I mean, it's literally got like beakers on the cover. So
And it's the first half of the book is the lecture, and the second half is the lab.
Yes.
And I think it's about 370 pages. Not that I keep track of how long these books are, but it's really big. It was a fast read, but he has updated it over the years. And this is based on all the work they've done for 20 years on content. So it's not a lot of theory. It's all based on what they found, and also uses data from Google and all the places that provide research, BuzzSumo and all kinds of places like that. And that was also one of my favorites of my content director. That was like the second book he read when he came to work for me. And I interviewed Andy for Authors in Quarantine Getting Cocktails, and I said, because I love that book, and I said, hey, are you going to do another one? And he goes, yes, I'm going to do another one, but, you know, it's kind of in the works, but I got to update it. And so then one day out of the blue this year, volume 6 showed up, and inside he wrote, Douglas, here it is. I've been thinking about you while I've been writing this. Thanks for the nudge. And I just thought, oh, he's thinking about me? He probably hates me. All right, Douglas, here's your book. No, he's not that way. But that is such a great book.
I've already told you this once, that all of us are writing books so that we can get on your podcast. Yeah, no, that's actually how that works. Did you not realize that? Yeah.
No.
Yeah, no, that's the big goal in life. Although I get another marketing book created so I can talk to Douglas again.
Yes. Love so, it. Well, happy to give all everybody these goals, but, you know, let's not forget I'm just a knuckleheaded podcaster who likes reading sales and marketing books.
It's so great. You're very encouraging. I don't want to make you blush, but you're a very encouraging podcast host as well. And that's exciting, too, to feel like you've got somebody who's ready to help you promote whatever you create. So it's...
you know, I appreciate that, because when I've invited an author on, you're not going to have a bigger advocate.
Yeah. And people don't realize that until they've been on your podcast once, which is why once I was on it once, I wrote a second book so I could get back on it. That's the whole reason I have a companion book to the first, is because that's how that works.
I've interviewed one author, David Mamet Scott, 8 times now.
Wow.
And Mark Schaefer, I've interviewed him 7 times, and I'm going to interview him in about 2 weeks for the 8th time. David Mamet Scott are getting very competitive.
Yeah, neck and neck. I love it.
With life goals.
Yes, exactly.
But it tickles me because, you know, I read the book. And the other thing is that I now get books almost every day.
Wow.
You know, because you get on a list and publishers know about you and authors know about 1/3 of my guests are now return guests.
Wow.
And so I'm not scaring too many of them off.
Yeah.
But the thing to know is that one of the few things I hate about the podcast is having to say no to an author. And really, it's just, does the book excite me? So when I talk about all these books saying, oh, it's a great book. Almost all of them are really great books because I kind of vet them and then I read them, and it's a topic that interests me. And that's not to say that a book that's not on the show is not a good book. It's just maybe one that I'm not particularly interested in right now. And so that's why I'm so excited to be able to interview these authors. And I can't imagine what it's like writing a book. I mean, most of these authors are putting their careers and their marriages and their families at risk, pouring their heart and soul and their lifetime of learning into a book. So, you know, my hat's off to these. So I'm the sports writer who can't believe he gets to interview these athletes. So,
oh my goodness. All right. See, this is why we all want to be on your podcast. So, all right, let's keep this going. Our lightning round is slowing down, so we got to speed it up.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
We got to get the lightning going again. So here we go. The next book recommendation, I'm going to ask you about the art of marketing and the science of marketing. What books would you recommend for those two categories?
The Art of Marketing, of course, these are hard to say because they're all such good books, but I would suggest The New Rules of Marketing and PR by David Merriman Scott, 8th edition. He updates the book every 2 or 3 years. So when we talk about how much marketing is changing and how much it's going to change, like since October and next year, he has to keep updating that book every 2 or 3 years because it changes so much. And it's a 400-something page book, but it's really, really good. And he's been updating it for 10, 15 years now. That's a book I often recommend if somebody says, what's the first book I should read about marketing to kind of understand what I need to know and what I need to not worry about? That's the book. And his book, The New Rules of Marketing and PR, is discovered an early copy of it years ago, first or second edition. And looking back, that's one of two books that have had the biggest impact on my career.
Cool.
I recommend that book, New Rules of Marketing PR, very strongly.
What about the science of marketing?
Two come to mind, which were both on the podcast this year, along with the 8th edition. So all these links are available. One is The Conversion Code Stop Chasing Leads and Start Attracting Clients by Chris Smith. It's in the second edition. It's one of the few books I've had come on, you know, in a subsequent edition. And there's another one that was just really, really well done by an executive at Google. The book is titled Converted, The Data-Driven Way to Win Customers' Hearts. Just a brilliant book. So I would recommend those two. Those are two that come to mind off the top of my head. There's certainly many others.
Right. I love it. That's great. And for anyone watching live, Stacy Cornelius, who's on my team, is in chat putting all of these book titles. So if you're watching the replay, you can look at the chat as well to get all the book titles. So, all right. What about quick reads? What would you recommend in that category?
There have been many, and I, you know what? It seems like it's more difficult. It must be more difficult to write a short book than a long book. Mm-hmm. But there's one that was quite good, and I know that some listeners they have like a book groups, and they asked me for a recommendation. And there's one by Rohit Bhargava, who is the author who's written, for years he would write the trends book every year, Non-Obvious Trends. And he wrote The Non-Obvious Guide to Small Business Marketing Without a Budget. And it was it's a short book. It's a small book. And I admired it like you might admire a piece of sculpture. Like, what did they leave on? And it's just really, really well done. Great, great first book if you don't know much about marketing or what you should do, or you're maybe a little overwhelmed by it, which is, I can completely understand. Mm-hmm. So that was a quick read that... I think it's just a very smart book. He's a very smart guy, very nice guy. He's the he also has a publishing company called Idea Press, and they publish books.
Cool. I didn't know that. That's very cool. Yeah. So it sounds like a quick read that's also informative. It sounds like it's useful. Super
yeah,
useful.
Yeah, fun, and the but it's also a topic that I think applies to everyone. Small business marketing without a big budget. I remember I teased him. I said, I don't know. That doesn't sound like, you know, much of a niche.
Is anyone
going
to be interested in that? I don't know. Yeah.
But you know what's funny? I think I may have mentioned this in the interview, as I said, there are a lot of big companies that aren't doing some of these basics.
Yes. Yeah. It's amazing what people forget, right? So, okay. What about when you think back to the books you've read, what's a book that had like really engaging stories in it that you enjoyed?
That is a great question. And it's another book that was on the show this year called The Secret Lives of Customers by David Scott Duncan. And you may have heard of the term Jobs to be Done, Clayton Christensen. He in fact, was a co-author of another book with Clayton Christensen from Harvard Business School before he passed away. But The Secret Lives of Customers is like a mystery, like a Sherlock Holmes mystery, but it's about a business and how they were trying to get more customers and find the more profitable customers and do the right thing and figure out what customers want. And I think, so this guy, David, he also had a PhD in physics from Harvard, so I knew he'd be comfortable with math. So I think 87% of the book was the mystery. It was just beautifully written, and he is a big Sherlock Holmes fan.
Yeah.
And then the last 13%, or I think I have the numbers right, he explains what the people were doing in the story, you know, from a business standpoint. It was almost like a, I don't know, what would you say, like an epilogue, or where you go back and they show you how they solved the mystery. And it was just beautifully written. I can't imagine how difficult it was to write, but it was great.
And it's a marketing book.
Yes.
Wow.
The Secret Lives of Customer. I mean, it's just, in fact, when I was interviewing him, I told him, I remember now, I said, you know, I sat down with the book on Sunday morning and I had the NFL channel on, and I muted that, but I was looking at it to see what games were coming up. And I got to page 125. The games were already playing. I was just like, I couldn't stop reading it.
Wow.
It really pulled me in. So I said, you know, something was a little more interesting than watching the all the pregame shows, NFL pregame shows that day. So
I'm going to look that one up. I love that because, you know, nonfiction books, I'm sure you have noticed the patterns. They tend to follow this structure where the first, I feel like the first, you know, 20% of most nonfiction books is talking about how what you really need to keep reading this book because you're going to learn this and this and this, kind of like selling the book that people have in their hands. Probably not the amazing books that you read, but a lot of sort
it's
of
not a bad idea though to make me want to.
Yeah, I just yeah, I get annoyed actually in those nonfiction books because I'm like, I already bought it. It's in my hands. I'm reading it. Like, can you start with the stuff that I bought this book for? You know what I mean? It's like, you know, the big build. It's like a buildup. Keep reading because we're going to cover this, this, and this. And I'm like, yes, I know. I read your book blurb and I have your book in my hand. So how about we get to it?
You know,
I
wonder if it's more difficult for an author to read a book than a non-author.
It probably is. And also because I have a design background, I do tend to pick up on patterns like that. So and then I get annoyed by them. So there you go. Okay. That tells you everything you need to know about me. But I love the idea of a book that completely breaks that pattern with a story that's engaging. That sounds amazing.
It is.
So, all right, next category is how to build long-term customer relationships. This is that retention thing that we talked about just a few minutes ago.
Yes, so a few popped into my head. Again, books that just got me really excited. Let me mention a couple. One of them is Never Lose a Customer Again by Joey Coleman. Phenomenal book. Such a great book. And he talks to you about, you know, what you can do to never lose a customer again. So, and create a good experience, but a lot of it has to do with understanding your customers. Heaven forbid. But it's a masterpiece. It's his first book. He was the joke was he was the only big time keynote speaker who didn't have a book. And he finally wrote this book, but you know what he did?
Yeah.
I'm convinced that these keynote speakers have some of the best books. Mm. Because like stand-up comedians, they've been practicing these stories for years.
Yes.
They understand pacing and engagement. And sure enough...
And they're testing their material with a live audience, right? So they can see what the reactions are.
I have not had a book by a famous keynote speaker that wasn't a good book. Mm. And Jay Baer, who I'm sure you know, he said, yeah, he doesn't write a book until he's given like 25 talks about it. About the big idea. And Joey Coleman said he went into a recording studio. I think he was in there for 10 hours and he just spoke the whole book, which became the first draft.
Oh, wow. So okay, that gives me an idea.
Yeah.
That's
a really good one. I just absolutely love it. There was another one that was on the show this year, which I thought was interesting, by Nicholas Webb. Also a keynote speaker, but he's written a number of books and he wrote this book called What Customers Hate.
Mm.
What's interesting, there have been a number of books on the show about customer relationships, customer experience, how to design a better experience for your customers, why that's so important. But what was interesting about this book is he said, you know, you should do that. You should want to aspire to that goal. But when you're doing it, start with what they hate. Because there are certain things they hate about your company or about your category that if you can address those first, the impact is most dramatic. And I just thought that was such an interesting approach.
Smart. Yeah, so smart. Yeah.
And so he talks about how in his career he's been sort of like a customer experience hazmat team where we go into these big companies and it'll be a nightmare. And they start with, basically stop the bleeding, you know?
Right.
So I thought that was, he's a fantastic writer. He's written books on innovation and he wrote another book called What Customers Crave. And the third book, which was a really great customer experience book, was called From Impressed to Obsessed by John Pico. He was on the show this year. And I think that might've been his first book published by McGraw-Hill, if I'm not mistaken. He's the person behind Watermark Consulting, which had been studying customer experience. And it was really, really well done. And as I recall, there were like 12 things that successful companies do to create a better customer experience. But he said, you don't have to do all 12. You just have to pick out the ones that are relevant and important to your customers in your category. But it was very, very well done. I liked it very much. So those are three right there. All three of them would be good books for CEOs to read.
Okay. I love it. So not just marketing people, but CEOs.
Yes.
Good to know. What about
a CEO who wants to keep their job and wants to grow revenue?
Keep some customers, you know, small stuff like that. Yeah. What about branding best practices?
Well, there was another book on the show this year by Uli Applebaum, and it was called The Brand Positioning Workbook. And it was the most practical book about how to do branding that I've ever heard of. And it had a lot more to do with your business strategy than, you know, logos, which people still think of as a brand. And that's why I don't have a whole lot of books about brands and branding on my podcast, because, you know, Jeff Bezos will say that your brand is what other people say about you when you're not in the room.
Mm-hmm.
And the Strattons, they've been on a few times. They wrote a book called Unbranding, and they said, you know, the most important branding department in your company is not marketing. It's your human resources department. It has to do with the kind of people you attract to work for you, how you treat them, how you train them, how you empower them, and how they treat your customers.
Yeah, so how they turn around and treat your customers.
There's too many books about brands and branding that seem to show up that it's not... It seems like it has more to do with how you run your company than what you say.
Yes.
And that's absolutely what people believe. They believe what other people say about you versus what you say. In fact, they're quite skeptical of what companies say about themselves.
Mm-hmm.
But his was very, very practical, very analytical. He's a German. and I liked it very much. Really, really well done. And he actually takes on some of those things that I mentioned about you know, some of the issues I have there as well about brands and branding, you know, the sort of the outdated approach of it's what we say about ourselves.
Right.
Nothing could be truer.
Right. Okay. So final category, what about just general inspiration?
I would say the book, I think it was on the 200th episode of the podcast, This is Marketing by Seth Godin. I mean, I just find him to be such an inspiring writer, and he's just as nice as he is smart, and he's a really nice guy.
Yeah.
And he's so famous, but his books are one of the few where when you read his book, it's like he knows what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
So it's kind of not creepy, but it's like, oh, damn it.
How did he get in my head?
Did he get in my head? And this is marketing. That's not the first book you want to read, but I think if you're an experienced marketer and you like reading those books, it's a book you're going to want to read slowly.
I love it.
It really is inspiring. And it's a book, I don't know if he said this, but it's a book that he couldn't have written earlier.
Hmm.
You know? It's only at this point is he able to look back and also distill a lot of the ideas from his previous books. It's not a greatest hits, but it's very, very inspiring. It really gets you thinking. I think you would really enjoy that one and the David Scott Duncan book.
Okay. Oh, that's good. Personalized recommendations. Thank you.
Yes. Well, for the fussy author who, you know.
Yeah, right, exactly. No, and for anyone watching, Douglas did mention that if you reach out to him on LinkedIn, he can make those recommendations to you. So if you're looking for a very targeted recommendation for a marketing book, just reach out to him. And I highly recommend that you listen to the Marketing Book Podcast, because you're hearing directly from the authors of these ideas. And Douglas, again, is a very generous interviewer. So it's an opportunity for you to learn in a way that is, it's a lot of fun, actually. It's fun for everyone involved, the listener, the guest, the host, everybody's having fun. So it's a great way to learn. Now, if people want to learn more, obviously the Marketing Book Podcast, but if they want to learn more about you, what is the best place for them to go?
Well, MarketingBookPodcast.com is the section of my website
mm-hmm.
for the podcast. It's a part of sales artillery. But if you go to marketingbookpodcast.com or connect with me on LinkedIn, if you can include a message so I know that maybe there's a connection here, because I get a lot of spammy LinkedIn connections. I try to weed them out. Otherwise, on Twitter, I'm Marketing Book. So that's a good one. And like I said, if I can recommend a book and save somebody time, please let me do that. I really enjoy you know, being able to help point people in the right direction. I get the nicest messages from people saying, hey, you know, I really appreciate you doing the podcast, which, you know, is like giving a drunk another drink. It's like, I'll never stop doing this now that I know I've helped somebody. Bob has a question. Doug, have you monetized your podcast? A little bit, but if you look up podcast monetization in a dictionary, you're not going to see my picture. So the reason why is because I started it for very personal reasons. You know, I had been this ad guy for many, many years, and I saw that whole world kind of coming to an end, and it was great, you know. And then I stumbled upon David Meerman Scott's book, and there was a few years there in the wilderness, as they might say, where I started to really feel particularly irrelevant. You know, I was having to bring website people to client meetings. What the heck's going on here, you know? And I felt like I was growing dinosaur scales, and I went back to doing what I had done in grad school, started reading a lot of books, and that's when I stumbled upon his book. And at that point, I saw where everything was going, pivoted the business, was very excited, and I ultimately decided to start the podcast. But the reason why is because I said, I swear I never want to, I've got to do something where I feel like I kind of know what's going on. And so that's why I do it. Now, over the years, there have been advertisers who've come along and said, we'd like to, you know, get in front of your audience, and they pay me for that. If you have any ideas on what else I could do, because a number of people are saying, you know, why don't you do more? Why don't you help the audience? And even Pamela, you and I have talked a little bit about this. I'm kind of thinking about what else I could do to add value that people might want to pay for. So, Bob, if that's really your name, no, I'm kidding. If you have any ideas, please let me know. Or if you know of a company that knows how to help people figure out what would work, let me know, because I hear from a lot of people asking me for more. And like I say, I've been doing this for me. You know, what can I do for other folks? But if anybody in my audience wants to send me a bottle of wine, I am not going to return it. So,
yeah. You return it empty for recycling. So,
yes.
Well, yes. I want to thank you so much for making time to chat with me today. And I just want to thank you for your work, really, Douglas, because you not only are inspiring marketers and marketing book authors, but you're inspiring the people who read these books and implement the ideas to continue to learn, to have that growth mindset that you clearly have. So I really appreciate you, and I thank you for the work you do. And thank you so much for making time to share your thoughts today. I really, really appreciate your presence.
Well, first off, thank you for laughing at a few of my jokes. I know you didn't want to, but I appreciate it. I appreciate our friendship. And, you know, it's through the podcast that I've gotten to meet people like you. And so I it's a labor of love, and it's the fun thing I get to do at work. So if I can recommend any books or help folks get them pointing in the right direction, I hope they'll let me know.
Awesome. We will put as many links as we can fit into the description below this replay. And thank you to everybody who spent time with us today. And if you watch the replay, this is the end. Congratulations, you made it. High five. So thank you for being with us. And we will see you in the months ahead in the marketing world. Have fun, everybody.